Good afternoon, or good morning, everyone. I'm thrilled to see so many people here. It's fantastic. It really is very gratifying to see everyone here for this conversation with Tatsuo Miyajima, the renowned Japanese artist whose installation is upstairs. I wanted to make this brief because Tatsuo has a presentation, and then he and I are going to have a conversation, which is going to be interpreted by Keita Moore, who is a translation expert from the University of California, Santa Barbara, I'm a PhD student there. So the show is on view until April 19th. It opened December 22nd. I hope many of you have had a chance to see it. Tatsuo and my relationship goes back to the late 1990s. I had seen his work for quite a long time before going to the Dallas Museum of Art as a curator of contemporary art there. And at that time, his exhibition was on view that was curated by my friend Michael Opping at the Modern Art Museum of Fort Worth. And so I saw the work there and wanted to get something for the Dallas Museum of Art. And that piece is Counterground, which is the central, very large ground piece in the exhibition upstairs. It's the first time Counterground has been outside of Dallas. And the other three works are borrowed from the Listen Gallery and the artist. I wanted to thank the Listen Gallery in London, New York, and Shanghai. Kat Lowe is here from the gallery. They've been enormously helpful and incredibly supportive of the project, which came together in a record seven or eight months. So, oops, there goes my water. I'd also like to thank our exhibition sponsors. I need to thank all of them correctly. The Dana and Albert R. Broccoli Charitable Foundation, Zora and Les Charles, Jacqueline Klein Brown, Carol McCorkle, SBMA Photo Futures, SBMA The Museum Contemporaries, Gwendolyn and Henry Baker, and the Lorna Spencer Hedges Photography Lecture Fund. So thank you to all of those entities. I also wanted to thank my incredible installation crew. For those of you who saw the Salt and Silver Photography Show 1840 to 1860, that was in the exact same space as Tatsuo's work. There were seven small galleries that have been reconfigured into the very beautiful and stately exhibition that you see upstairs. And so I couldn't be happier to be working with all of my colleagues here at the Santa Barbara Museum of Art to realize this installation. We have an incredible crew here, every single one of them. I can't name them all, but when you see them, thank them for me as well. Just a bit of a background. Oh, and I also wanted to thank Fabian Leva Barragan, who has been central to the success of this installation. He is the curatorial assistant in the Department of Photography and New Media. Just by way of background, and Tatsuo will talk more about it, he was born in 1957 in Tokyo and studied there and has had exhibitions around the world. A current exhibition is at the Espoo Museum in Helsinki, Finland, as well as a group exhibition at Somerset House in London. He represented his nation, Japan, in 1999 at the Venice Biennale. His works are in the collection of the Tate, the Dallas Museum of Art, Fort Worth Modern, Denver Art Museum, the Cartier Foundation for Contemporary Art, and numerous collections and museums in Japan. So with that, I would like to introduce Tatsuo Miyajima. We're so honored to have you here, and thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm very honored to be here. この展覧会を実現するためにこの美術館そして関係者の皆様にお礼を言いたいと思います。
So first things first, I'd like to thank both the museum and everyone who has come together here for making this a possibility, for making this a reality.
特にチャーリー、企画してくれたチャーリーには、感謝申し上げます。
I'm extremely grateful particularly to Charlie who has really made this possible.
じゃあプレゼンテーションを始めたいと思います。
I'd like to begin the presentation now.
Pardon? Ah, yeah, okay. 私はアーティストとしてデビュー以来30年仕事をしてきましたが、一貫して同じ、基本のコンセプトを貫いています。
So、I debuted as an artist 30 years ago, but through all this time since my debut,、there has been one series of core concepts that have unified my work.
それは3つ、それは変化し続ける、それは荒いものと関係を結ぶ、それは永遠に続く。この基本コンセプトに基づいて作品それぞれ違うテーマで、仕事をしてきています。
These three themes are 1. Keep changing 2. Connect with everything 3. Continue forever. Based on these three core concepts, I have developed my body of work、over the years, once again trying to always keep these in mind.
この写真はカウンターガジェットと呼んでいて、先の3つのコンセプトを表現するためにオリジナルで作っています。1から9、あるいは9から1とカウントをします。しかし0は表記されない。実際の映像を見てみます。
So this、photo that you see before you is called Counter Gadget. And it was one of the first attempts at really creating a piece that expresses these, an original piece that expresses these three ideas.It counts from 1 to 9 or from 9 to 1. However, 0 never is displayed. As you can see, this is it in action.
このように数字を光らせながらカウントして、0で暗闇になります。私は1988年からこのようなデジタルカウンターを使っています。今は LED もいろいろな色が出てきていて、赤や緑、そして黄色や青、そして白、最近ではピンクやフルカラーまで表現できるようになりました。このカウントするスピードは速くしたり遅くしたり自由に設定できます。
So in this way,、I have made pieces where the light, where these numbers will light up, and then when the counter reaches zero, the piece goes dark.、from 1988, I have been using this kind of digital counter through、almost all of my work, and.Recently,、there are a lot of different colors of LED lights that have been put to market. Obviously, red,、blue, green,、yellow as well, white, and most recently pink, and actually multi-chromatic LEDs have come to market, and I've been using them to express myself.、the speed of the counter itself can be accelerated and slowed down. In other words, it can be freely set.
さて、このカウンターガジェットは時間も表現していますが、仏教哲学における人の命を表彰しています。
This、piece that you can see now is called Counter Gadget, and it's really an expression of time,、but particularly an expression of time as seen from the perspective of a Buddhist philosophy of people's life and as a symbol thereof.
仏教哲学では人は何度でも様々な姿で生まれ変わると説かれています。だから私は9から1とカウントして動く数字を生として考え、そして0の暗闇を死として表現しています。
So in Buddhist philosophy or in Buddhist thought、people will die countless deaths and then be reborn、countless lives in countless different forms、therefore By using the 9 to 1 to count down and these moving numbers to count down、or count up, I'm expressing life, or I'm thinking of this as life. Whereas 0, the darkness that、embodies 0, is expressing death.
そしてそれが繰り返されることで永遠の生命感を表しているのです。日本の仏教哲学者である池田大作博士は生命を以下のように表現しています。一日に例えてみるならば、朝日が昇り目を覚ます、それが生である。その生の延長として一日の行動が始まる。そして一日の活動を終えて疲れを癒すために家路につく。夜、明日の生のために休息につく。これすなわち一日の死である。これと同じように一生の価値ある活動を終え、新たな活力のある生命力を得るために死という方便の姿を示すのです。
So,
it's a long sentence.
This version of、kind of repetition that, and cyclicality that runs through my work is really to express a perpetual or an eternal view of life.、the Japanese Buddhist philosopher Dr. Ikeda Daisaku、 has this to say about what life means in a Buddhist context. So if we were to make a metaphor of the Buddhist cycle of life and death in a single day, it would begin when the sun rises and we awake. This is life. In order to extend life, you then have your daily toils, and this begins after you awaken. When you have finished toiling at the end of the day, in order to cleanse your tiredness, you return home, and then in the evening, of course, you fall asleep in order to replenish your energy for the next day's toils. If we think about this, then in fact, going to sleep is like the daily death. And in a similar way, a single life's value, having been toil, having been existence in the world, ends once, and then in order to birth a new kind of active life, you have to pass through death. And this is taken from Ikeda Daisaku's, for anyone who's interested, Buddhist Laws and the Universe, which is, came out in 1984.
Thank you. And, じゃあ実際の作品を見てみます。これはあの最初に最初の方で作った作品で時間の基本的なイメージを作っています。
So let's look at some more concrete examples of this. This is one of my earlier works from 1989, and it's really dealing with this question of time, and particularly the idea of time as linear.
これも同じような時期に作った作品で、カウンターサークルという作品です。
This is another piece made around the same time, so around 1989, called Counter Circle.
私の作品は動いているので、次に動画をちょっと見てもらいます。これはシドニー現代美術館で2016年に行われたショーの模様です。
So because my pieces are designed to be, to move, essentially, I'd like to show a video of this, which was installed in 2016 in the Museum of Contemporary Art in Australia.
はい、次にお見せするのは、上海で行われたプロジェクト「カンタスカイガーデン」という作品です。この作品には、上海市民300人が、参加して一緒に作り上げた作品です。
So this piece that you can see before you now, is one that I did in, is a project that I conducted in Shanghai. It's called Counter Sky Garden. And one of the really special parts about this is that it actually involved bringing together 300 residents of Shanghai and working collaboratively with them to create this.
Hi.それでは、次にお見せするのが香港の ICC タワーという巨大なビルディングの壁面を使ったプロジェクト、この展覧会にも出品しているタイムウォーターフォールという、種類の作品です。
So the next piece I'd like to show you, was in Hong Kong, and it was on the ICC Tower, which is a very large, very famous building that you can be, that you can see here. And it was using the walls of this building.In fact, it belongs to the same body of work as the Time Waterfall piece that can be seen, upstairs in this exhibition.
Thank you. Wow. So nice reaction. これはあの、同じコンセプトを上の作品でも、持ってます。はい。
So this is the same basic concept as, of course, the piece upstairs, which is also entitled Time Waterfall.
はい。これはあの、この作品、この展覧会にも出品している空ウォールという作品です。空という概念を黒い作品として表しています。
So this is one of the pieces that has been currently installed in this museum. It's called Life or the Ku Wall. And it's taking the Buddhist concept of Ku and displaying it against this, or through this black panel.
この作品では人工知能 AI を使って周りの LED の動きと関連付けて自分のカウントのスピードを決めていきます。ですからどういうふうになるか私も分かりません。
One of the most interesting things about this piece is that actually it's using AI to decide when the numbers will light up and when they will not light up and also in what order. And so in a way, using this AI, the numbers are speaking to one another.But what this means in practice is that I have no idea when things are going to happen and in what order.
次に Innumerable Life Buddha という作品です。これは無名の名もない人々の命が無数に輝いて壮大な宇宙そのものを表している作品です。
So this is a piece entitled Innumerable Life / Buddha, which is really thinking about the innumerableand unnamed lives of people lighting up. And then thinking about this in terms of a grand universe of these processes continuing.
この作品は、カウントグラウンドという作品で、共通の問題意識、さっきの、インヌメラブルと共通の問題意識を持っています。
So this piece is Counterground, which Charlie also mentioned in his, introductory remarks.And it is using the same basic idea of the repetition and the countless lives and deaths of countless beings in the universe.
それぞれの LED は違うリズムを持っています。それが、まあ、生命が地から湧き出るような、そんなイメージを表現しています。
So this one, the individual rhythms of the numbers are actually all completely different.And so it is really a testament to the kind of life that comes out from the ground, the life that we're all living communally together in the universe.
これは前述の、無数の名もない人々の生命で、仏教では自由の菩薩と言われる仏様です。仏典には世界を変えるのは天から降りてくる秀才たちではなく、地から湧き出る普通の人々であると説かれています。無数の庶民が持っている無限の可能性を称賛した作品です。
So, as I've mentioned before, the idea of the countless lives of the nameless, people throughout the universe, is tied to the idea of the Buddhist notion of bodhisattvas of the earth. And within Buddhist scripture, it's believed that the people who will change the world are not the people who, as it were, descend from heaven, the kind of brilliant,shining stars, but rather the people who arise from the earth, the normal people who arise from the earth. And in this way, this piece is really, and Buddhist scripture, is thinking through the kinds of limitless possibilities that live within the nameless masses.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you. So. Is this on? So, Tatsuo, that was a wonderful introduction. The work is so multivalent, so multi-layered, and that gave us a real sense of so much of what you've done. And one of the counterground, I know, has something to do with landscape as well. Can you talk about that a little? The landscape that, when I asked you to create a commission in the Dallas Museum of Art, can you talk about the idea of landscape in that work?
はい。まずチャーリーからコミッションワークを作ってくれって言われたときに、まあ、普通だったら壁にかける作品を想定をするんですけれども、ダラスそしてアメリカという、ことを考えたときに僕はやっぱりフラットな土地をまずとても印象に受けたのでそういうものを表現したいというふうに思って カウンターグラウンドという作品を考えました。
So when Charlie came to me with this commission for the Dallas Museum of Art, normally you would think of a wall-based installation. But when I was thinking about Dallas and the United States, really what caught my attention and what really remained as an impression for me was the flatness of the land, the kind of expansiveness of it. And so in order to give an expression to that, I designed Count It Round.
And so it really is, I hesitate to say a portrait, but it is among your works something that is representational in a way that some of the others are not. Another concept that I think is really extraordinary about the work, and you don't have to translate this because it's a lot, but is the idea of silence and how all of the LED numerals play different parts in our lives. And I keep thinking about when we see these things in our daily lives telling us to get up or stop driving so fast or all these other kind of, like get the water off the stove, all these other kinds of things that we have this relationship to. And you're bringing a completely different relationship to technology than we're used to having. And it calls on something different than that we have to kind of, you know, rethink. Because it's not, the numbers are not telling us facts, and they're not telling us, you know, data necessarily. In general, what made you turn to technology as your medium?
テクノロジーというのはあくまでも僕にとっては、自分のコンセプトを表現するために、とても表現しやすいのでそのテクノロジーを使っています。
So, the reason that I've turned to technology is, in a sense, quite simply that it allows me to express my concept. It's really the means with which I'm, well, expressing myself.
でただテクノロジーの進歩というのは本当に早いのでいろいろな変化があります。でその時々によって自分の、コンセプトまたはテーマをうまく説明できるテクノロジーがあればそれを、取り入れて使新しいテクノロジーも使うようにしています。
That being said, as you all know, the progress and the changes within technology are very fast. And the advance is quite rapid. And so sometimes I find that new technologies, when I see them, I'm very eager to use them in my work because they allow me to express something different than I had in the past.
And what is interesting, as you will see upstairs, what is interesting is that Counterground actually is quite simple, admirably simple in its technology because it's 2x4s with plywood on top that's been painted black. And then all the 400 plus numbers are there. And then bookcasing it are these two extraordinarily sophisticated technological works. Do you work with computer scientists, electrical engineers? Who are the people you work with?
クオールという作品では最新の AI の技術を使っています。で、それは、東京大学の、生命工学の先生、この先生にプログラムを作ってもらっています。ですので私もどういう動きをするのか全くわからないです。
So in the piece upstairs, Kuwal, this is my first experiment with AI, and I actually went to a friend of mine who works at Tokyo University, which for those of you who know is a very very prestigious university in Japan,who's in bioengineering, and I got him to make a program to control these numbers. But once again, just to restate it, I really have no idea what's going to happen because of this program with the numbers.
But it is an interactive piece, correct?
Yeah.
The body of the... So when you go upstairs in our Colfax Gallery, as it's called, where Life Kuwal is installed, it's the piece that is... that greets you when you leave the elevator, and then over here will be the introductory text. So if you come and no one's around, I've been there when the screen is completely dark.
Yeah.
And when you, there's a little motion sensor at the lower left hand, and when you or whoever walks by, all of a sudden the numbers start to effloresce. Mm. And it's a marvelous experience because, you know, you kind of, you're a little bit surprised, like, oh, it's doing something. And this is different because the numerals in, well, all the other three that we have are programmed. And someone asked, actually, it was really interesting, about Counterground, do the numbers depend on each other? But they really don't. But Untitled Kuwal does. What I find amazing about the Innumerable Life Buddha, the one that's on the wall, and then Counterground that's on the floor, it's a variation on two themes, which is the square with the numerals going at different levels, different speeds. The idea of the individual within the group, I think on Listen's Gallery's website, there's a very, or maybe it's on your website, and I urge you both to see both of these websites because there's wonderful interviews with Tatsuo. And when you talk about Innumerable Life Buddha, you talk about the story of the Buddha who it was clear he was going to be leaving the world, and I think they said to him, who's going to be the next Buddha? Can you talk about that? Because I think that that's very beautiful, that story.
Yeah.
もともとそのブッダとか仏教の考え方というのは、神という考え方ではなくて、それぞれの人々が、すべての人々にその仏性といって仏の可能性が存在して、みんなそれぞれ一人一人が持ってるっていうふうに説かれてるんですね。なのですべての人たちは等しく平等で等しくクリエイティブなんですね。
So originally, the way that Buddhism thinks about divinity is not in terms of a singular god. Rather,Buddhism has a theory of the individual where the individual has what I think is normally translated as Buddha essence, or the latent potential to become a Buddha. And that's within everybody, that's within every individual. And so consequently, when you're thinking about things like the individual and creativity, in fact, we are all equal, precisely because we all have this potentiality, this latent possibility of Buddhahood.
And the work, love, especially when having lived with Counterground now for, you know, a long time and thought about it, each of the little numbers have their own personality. And you wouldn't call it anthropomorphic because obviously it's a little unit, but it is funny to, and it's, you know, endearing to see one going very, 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 very fast and the other just kind of going along. And then one, another, and then another that the where the unit goes dark. And one of the very conscientious guards we have here, they're marvelous, said, how do we know if one of them's broken? And I said, don't do that to yourself. Because you really can drive yourself, you know. But there is this beautiful rhythm to them all when there are things that go dark. How long did you program? When they go dark, are they different times of going dark?
そのスピード、それぞれ違うスピードで400個余りが動いているんですが、そのスピード設定するときに、その全体でこうハーモニーが出てくるような感じでスピードを設定するんですね。それがとても時間もかかるんですけども、はい。
So with this particular piece, there are some 400 individual lights going on, and they do have individual speeds. But the way that I actually approach this, to kind of answer the question of the interval of darkness, is really in terms of the overall harmony of the piece. Do the rhythms match one another? Do they not match one another? Which is quite difficult, but it's really, I think, what makes the piece beautiful is this harmony of the lights.
So it's not, you just didn't place them all randomly.
Yeah.
Which in and of itself is an incredible achievement that I think would drive me insane. But I think that that level of both control but spontaneity, because it feels spontaneous, is really quite great. And the other thing that is extraordinary about it is that if you think about all of the numbers and different permutations and combinations, the mind reels because of the that you will never see that piece repeat itself. Is that correct? Both the counterground and innumerable life Buddha, they will never be the same.
No.
So in that way, it's a very simple but profound way to embody infinity, because there's this notion of linear sequences of 10 minus 9 minus 8 minus all these things that and which you then multiply each other. I can't believe I'm talking about this. You multiply these things, and when they exist on the screen or when they don't, there's no way for you to actually experience this thing twice. And so it's like any kind of experience we have. Like today will be not today in an hour. It will be a different kind of time period. But it's using technology in a way that is quite profound. And you don't have to answer this, but that's one of my attractions to your work over the years, has been how you embody these ideas with contemporary technology. Can you talk a little bit about the use of red? And I should say that when I chose the works, they were available from Listen Gallery, but also I knew I wanted the Dallas Museum of Artwork, which was red. And when I chose the works, there were three reds and then the pale or purple piece. And as you see, Tatsuo has worked with a range of different colors, but I wanted to kind of concentrate on the idea of red because in a way it is your signature color, and not totally, but in a way it is your signature color. Can you talk about red and its significance?
赤というのは、その、まあ、生命を表す、血といいますか、その生命力というか、そういうのも表すし、それから炎とか、それから何よりもその注意喚起を促すもの、ですよね。ですので赤色を使って自分のコンセプトを人々にこう強く訴えるために、赤色を頻繁に使っています。
So red for me, in the first place, is really symbolic of life energy, of life more generally speaking. But it also signifies things like fire, things with quite a lot of energy in their own right. And then finally, I use it really to reach the audience, because it is a color that attracts attention. And so by doing this, I can create an environment where people will be attracted to my work and then consequently to the message of it.
And in one of your videos, you talk about it almost being aggressive, which I find interesting, because a lot of the work is very kind of meditative or transfixing, but it's not passive. And when you have red like that, it is confronting, confrontational in a certain way. And so it's not a passive experience, which I find really interesting, because it does demand, attention from people, and especially the Innumerable Life Buddha. When you approach it, you might not even realize that it's numbers, and it is an experience to walk up, because it is powerful. Mm-hmm. There is power in that, like literal power, but also, you're standing in front of it, experiencing this idea of power, which. Very moving, and why I wanted one of those pieces in particular for the exhibition. And then the other thing, now that I'm thinking of it in terms of time waterfall, the idea of the wrapping around and the numbers falling obviously has to do with a kind of representation, again, I'm contradicting myself, of a thing in nature. Can you talk about, I know it's a big subject, but the role that nature plays in the work, because it is so technologically oriented, there is quite a bit of nature in the work.
僕にとってはその自然というのはとても重要で、僕のコンセプトを説明するためにテクノロジーを使うんですけれども、それが自然でないと人々に伝わっていかないというふうに思っています。それからアートっていうのは基本的にその古今東西どんなアートを見ても、良い作品というのはとても自然に近いんですよね。ですのでいい作品を作るためにも自然のリズムというのは とても重要に考えています。
So in my work, nature is very important. You know, obviously I'm using technology to express my core concepts, but I think that actually if there isn't something natural about the piece, that something natural in its rhythm, something natural in its composition, then it really can't say anything, it can't convey a message. And so for me, the idea of nature enters into my work in terms of really what makes a good piece and a bad piece. A good piece has a kind of natural harmony, a natural rhythm to it. A bad piece doesn't, and then consequently doesn't convey, doesn't express.
But we never see those. We never see the bad pieces. They don't leave the studio. So this is Tatsuo's first exhibition in the, organized by the United States Museum in over 20 years. And I wanted to honor my colleagues here at the museum for bringing this together, because to me it's very gratifying personally, but also my colleagues have done an extraordinary job in bringing this to fruition. The exhibition at the Espoo Museum, can you just talk a little bit about that? This is a modern art museum outside of Helsinki. Mm. Can you describe, it's a much larger show. And
yeah. フィンランドで初めての個展だったんですけども、そのフィンランドの、ヘルシンキのちょっと離れたところの町の美術館でやったんですけども、その非常に大きな作品を、コミッションで作ってくれっていうことで、展覧会が組まれたんですね。
So this is my first time exhibiting in Finland. And this museum itself is actually a little bit away from Helsinki. But the reason that I have been showing there is because I got a commission to create a very, very large piece.
その作品は天井に LED をつけて、Sky of Time という作品なんですけど、まるでそれはオーロラがこう天空を動いているような、そういうイメージの作品ですね。
So I've been using LEDs on the ceiling of the building, and the basic idea is to kind of capture through these lights the idea of the aurora and the movement of light that accompanies that.
The aurora
borealis.
Borealis. Wow, that sounds amazing. Let's go to Finland. And then one last question, and then we'll open it to the audience for questions. The reason I asked about Finland and then this show, when you see your work together, number one, does it, in general, how does that feel? But then does it spark thoughts for new direction in your work? And what are you working on now, if you would be willing to share with us?
今作ってる作品のことについてですね。
そうですね。はい。こういう展示会で、はい、自分のご自分の作品の、要は組み合わせを見て、何か新しい発想とかはないんでしょうか？
ですね、今回の展示を見てですね、非常にこうレイアウトがすごい綺麗だなと思いました。僕は全く考えてないんですけども、
彼が考えたんです。非常に綺麗な展示で、非常にびっくりしましたね。はい。
So in terms of this particular exhibit and the layout of this one, I was really struck by how pretty it was. When I make work, I don't really think about the layout. I sort of leave that to good friends who can do it for me and make it look very pretty. But in this particular instance, I was really shocked by how wonderful it all came together. So thank you, Charlie.
Thank you very much. That's great. Much appreciated. Why don't we have some time to take questions from the audience, and I'm so struck by how many people are here. It's fantastic. Thank you all for coming. And there have been so many questions that people have asked me, and now that you're here, we can have the source of all knowledge talk about it. So, questions? Anybody have? Yes, sir. Yeah.
Well, I was just wondering. Usually, we count a life going up. Can you talk about your conception of life counting down from 9 to 1? What that means for you, the way you think about life?
カウントアップとおっしゃる通り、カウントアップとカウントダウンをするんですけれども、カウントアップっていうのは、なんていうのかな、前にこう進んで生きていく感じですね。前に進んでいく感じ、はい、そしてカウントダウンというのは、ゼロというのを強調するためにカウントダウンをしています。つまりそれは後ろ向きというよりは、死に向かって、今人生というのはその死に向かって残り時間をこう過ごしていく、そんなイメージなので、そのような感じでカウントダウンを使っていますね。
So thank you for your question. As you point out, when the count goes up from 1 to 9, then that is really the idea of sort of living forward, of thinking in the future. But when things are counting down and approaching zero, I really do this to stress the presence of zero. So in other words, not to really think about retreating from life, but rather to think about progressing forwards to and in an awareness of death.
Yes, sir.
In counting ground, are all the digits totally independent, or is there some interaction with nearby digits?
いい質問ですね。実は、全てのカウンターガジェットはインディビジュアルに動いているんですが、いくつかのガジェットは関係づけられているんです。
あ、そうですか。
はい。で、それはパネルの中に、データ線というのが、信号を送る線があって、でこっちが、9から0になるときに桁上がりをして、こちらに信号を送るようになっているんです。でそれがいくつか存在してるんです。
So that is a really interesting question. Because in fact, although all of the individual LED panels are individual, there are some that are linked together at the level of the background circuitry. And so, for example, there are some panels where, due to the wiring, when one panel reaches zero, another one will actually click up to indicate that this one has reached zero or has reached 9 or whatever. And so there are some interesting interrelations within the piece.
Okay, thank you.
I didn't know that. Yes.
I was just wondering if you could answer the last part of Charlie's last question, which was, what are you working on now, if you'd be willing to share that with us?
あるいはこれから作っていきたい作品とは何かっていう、進化は何かっていうことですね。
ですね、今ちょうど作っている作品というのが、フルカラーの、一つのデジタル数字が今同じ色でこう9から1、そして0がなくてもう一回繰り返すっていうふうになってますよね。それが9から1になって、次の時に色が変わるようになれるんですね。フルカラーの LED があって、で、それを使って今作品をこう作っている最中です。
So to answer your question, that's very moment what I'm in the middle of making is something using the full color potentials of LEDs. And so basically what I'm doing is as a number will count down, once it reaches zero, then the color will change. And so I'm using color to kind of highlight the repetitions within these LED signals.
Sounds complex. Yes, Susan.
Could you please tell us a little bit about your installation in Naoshima, Japan?
Thank you for bringing that up. So, sorry. Just as a background, many people have been very aware of Tatsuo's work because of his work in Naoshima Island. And I have not been there, so I need to go. Can you explain it to me? Thank you for that question, Susan.
まず直島の作品について見たっていう人がとても多いんですけど、この中で見たっていう人はちょっと手を挙げてもらえますか。
So, slightly to my surprise, I discovered that many people who've attended this exhibition have actually been to see the Naoshima exhibits. So first of all, if you have been to Naoshima, could you please raise your hand in the audience?
Wow. Oh my God. Wow.
どうして
なんでしょうね、こんなに多いのね。
I wonder why. How did you end up going to Naoshima? Being a slightly difficult to get to place.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a very long way.
Hi. Our museum has travel programs.
So right.
Ah,
thank
so.
You.
We have
a very extensive travel program, and Lisa Benchia will be happy to talk to you about it.
I see.
Yes, we've done many trips to Japan and to Naoshima.
Ah, that's why. Thank you.
その
Naoshima の作品というのはですね、Sea of Time という作品なんですけども、水の中に LED が光っているんですね。カウンティングしています。でそのカウンティングするスピードを直島っていう小さな3000人ぐらいの島なんですけど、3000人の人口しかない、その中から125人に参加してもらって、それぞれの自分の好きなスピード設定をした LED が水の中に沈んでいるんです。それがもう20年間動き続けています。
So the main piece at Naoshima is called Sea of Time. Basically, it's LEDs counting backwards that have been submerged in the water. But as for the actual counting speed and how this was set, so Naoshima has a population of around 3,000 people. And I have worked with about 125 of them, having them come in and set their own rhythms for the countdown of the LEDs. And then having submerged them, this process of counting, the sort of participatory remainder has been going on for about 20 years.
で中にはですね、亡くなられた方もいるんです。もう20年経ちますからね。何人かのカウンターガジェットの方は亡くなられて、その子供さんたちが、その亡くなられた方を偲んでその作品を見に来たりしてます。
So, because this has been going on for so long, in fact, among the original people who set the counters, a number of people have passed away, sadly. But what's interesting is actually their children will come to the exhibit to look at their parents, their relatives' counter in order to remember them and commemorate them.
That's beautiful. Yes.
I've given many tours of the show so far, and I had a quick question about your message of peace. It's a very beautiful, positive, uplifting show, but I've also done some reading about your thoughts of a world of peace and no more weapons, and I wondered if you could speak a little bit about that.
僕がそのアーティストとして作品を作ってるっていうのは、生命の力強さとその重要性について、皆さんとシェアをしたいからなんですね。で、そうでなければ僕が作品を作る意味は全くないんです。ですから、その、核兵器の問題についてもいろんなところで、プロジェクトをやっていますし、そういう平和についてのメッセージというのは非常に強く僕自身が持っています。
So because my really my purpose as an artist is to deal with life, the power of life, and the importance of life. And this is one of the reasons why I make art, is to share this message with the world. And I really feel that unless I can do this, unless I can kind of access this meaning of life, there is no meaning in art. There is no meaning for me to go forward here. And so this has really informed my thinking about, for example, nuclear weapons or sites of nuclearity more generally. And I've been to these places. I have, on occasion, made work there. But all of these are really a way to think about peace, and through peace to think about life.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. I'm wondering, where can I get a shirt like that?
あ
のこれはですね、去年僕の友達のファッションデザイナーでブランドがあるソフというファッションブランドがあるんですが、そこで作った作品でワンシーズンのリミテッドなんですね。ですからもうあのソールドアウトしてしまいました。
残念ですね。So thank you for noticing. Some creative interpretation. But so actually, this shirt, a friend of mine who was a fashion designer last year put this together for a brand called Sofu. And it was a limited time, one season run. So unfortunately, you're out of luck unless you can buy one.
Yeah, I'll attempt to language this as best I can since I'm not a mathematician. But you're relying on Western number system, the 9 through 1 and 0. So in terms of the Orient and the indigenous mathematical system of that area, in terms of how physics and science developed, is it the same? Is there a concept of zero and infinity in the East similar? Are they directly analogous? Do you understand?
あのとても面白い質問で、あの僕もその数学とか物理学は大好きなんですね。それで、西洋におけるゼロっていうのはナッシングネスなんですけど、実はインドで5世紀ぐらいにゼロが発見されたんですね。その時のゼロの、意味はエンプティネスっていうのもあるんですけど、もう一つ増大っていう意味が、二つの意味が同時に備わった数字がゼロだったんです。
増大とおっしゃいますね。
増大というのはエクスプロージョンというかな、はい、そう、もうゼロはナッシングですでしょ。それで増大っていうのはバッとこう広がって、もう
全
て、全てという感じですかね。
はい、かしこまりました。 So, this is a very interesting question. I also really love math and physics. And when we think about the Western or the European concept of zero, it typically means nothing. But when you think about the invention of zero in India in roughly the 5th century, at that point in time it actually had two meanings. The first of which was emptiness. But the second of which really was something like an explosion, a sort of plentitude, simultaneously.
Is it, and I'm sorry, I'm going to ask my own question. Is there, I've been thinking about the concept of ku and zero, and is there something about empty and full that has a relationship to that?
Yeah.
Because I kind of describe it as, what does it mean to have an empty sky or an empty ocean? Because it's both present and absent at the same time. I don't know if that concept ever enters your...
あの、面白いのはですね、今でもそのゼロっていうのは、あの、ちょっと、あ、はい、なんか書くものがあるといいんだけど、あ、いいですか。はい、今でもそのゼロの、2つの意味っていうのは現実的に使っているんです、日常的に。例えばですね、ゼロがあったとして、右側にどんどんゼロ行くと、ゼロ、どんどん少なくなりますよね。
So when you, there are two commonly used meanings of the term zero. So if you have zeros like this lined up, it means that the content or the ultimate value in the system is getting smaller the further, the more zeros you add.
で、あの逆側に書くとどんどん増大していくんです。
However, if you go the opposite way, it gets fuller and fuller and fuller and fuller by means of these empty zeros.
だからゼロの意味は両方の意味があるってことですね。
So zero has both of these aspects to it, both the empty and then the plenty, I suppose.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just as a follow-up, real quick, in the math system of the Japan, there's symbol for six and there's a symbol for five and three, right? Did you ever consider embedding those symbols, those numerical equivalents in your art instead of relying on, well, I guess is Arabic numerals?
So there's a very simple answer to the question. If you use the kanji, so the Chinese characters for numbers, you limit your audience. Because people overseas can't see. Yeah.
Connect. Yes.
I have a simple question. What kind of artwork did you like to do when you were a child?
インパクトを受けたのは、バン・ゴッホですね。ゴッホとセザンヌですね。インプレッショニズムアートから
So as a child, what was really impactful was Van Gogh and Cezanne, so the Impressionists.
Yeah, normal.
Normal.
Very normal.
We'll have one last question because we got to get out of here.
Thank you. Thank you for your work, for being here, for your presentation. I really respond to your three principles for your work. With your use of AI now, maybe a fourth principle is needed, and that would be there is always the unknown.
もう一つは必要なのではないか。それは何かっていうと、無知、知らないものもすでに存在してるっていうことなのではないか。それ、そのような考え方を提供したようですね。確かにね、とても面白い質問ですね。実は今作ってる作品というのは、指示体というのはフレームとかそういうのが全然なくて、 位置も定まらないようなアンステイブルというようなコンセプトを立てて作っているんですね。つまりその偶然性とか未知なるものというかわからないものという世界に今その挑戦しようとしているところですね。
So thank you for a very interesting question and comment. Actually, one of the things that I'm currently working on is a making of sort of a frameless, very free-flowing piece that really lacks stability. And in so doing, I'm really playing around with ideas like chance, like contingency, and the unknown, and how to transform these concepts into sort of an artistic world of my own.
Thank you.
So in closing, I want to thank Keita Moore for your amazing talk. Pleasure to get to know you. And then, of course, I want to thank everyone who made the talk possible, but also Tatsuo, who came here yesterday for the very first time. And I think we would love to have you come back. And
yes.
Please enjoy the exhibition upstairs. It's on view until April 19th. And enjoy the rest of your day. And thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. Thank you.